So, hello students. Today we are here to talk about the fabric structure. Now, coming to the second basic method of fabric construction, or the structure to be made, is the knitting. We all know what is knitting, because knitting is a garment, or knitted garment is something which we use during the cold seasons to protect us from the cold. So, this structure is something which is airy. It is an open structure, unlike the woven structure. But at the same time, it has some insulated pockets which will not allow the cold air to reach our body. So that is the reason why we feel very warm. And in fact, these structures are very stretchable. You all know t-shirts and sweaters, how stretchable they are. So the stretchability is a factor that is created because of the knitting structure. In fact, hand knitting, you all know that we use only two needles to do a hand knitting, which you can make a complete garment out of it. Similarly, this hand knitting is been converted into the machines. So hand knitting is a method which was done earlier, and that has replaced by machines, which we call it as weft knitting. So the word knitting has come from another word called as knot. So it has been derived from that. And when we see the type of knitting that happens, we have basically two methods. One is the warp knitting and one is the weft knitting that happens with the machine. So in case of weft knitting, it is similar to other hand knitting, where one single thread is used to create the whole garment. That's what we do even with hand knitting as well. So even in the machine knitting of weft knitting, we can see that one single thread is used for the construction of the whole fabric, either it be a flat fabric or a circular fabric or a fully fashioned, we say. So unlike the warp knitting, in warp knitting what happens is, here there are series of threads which are given to the needles to form the loops. The basic structure of knitting is formation of loops and interloops and intermeshing of all these loops. So if the loops are formed in a fabric structure vertically, we call them as veils. And if the structure is made in a horizontal manner, we call them as courses. So veils and courses, like we have warp and weft for weaving, here we have veils and courses for the knitted fabric. So these two, the amount of veils and courses in a fabric will tell us the quality of the fabric, like that of the thread count in the woven fabric. So either one series of thread or maybe many series of thread in the weft knitting and the warp knitting. So in weft knitting, basically we can see there are three basic stitches that we do: knit and purl, tuck stitch and mist stitch. These are the three basic stitches where all the structures are made on these stitches only. So these three basic stitches will also help in making three basic fabrics called the jersey, the purl fabric and the knit fabric. So these three fabrics are made, and not only that, over and above that, using the tuck and mist stitches, we get a lot many structures with different textures, which is possible with that. And the yarn that is used in knitting, when we see, it is unlike the yarn that is used in weaving, where it is highly twisted and very stronger. Here, because we want to get a fabric which is really light in weight, at the same time protect us. So the yarn is given low twist so that the fabric is really something which is light in weight. At the same time, because of this looping, the structures become very easy enough and stretchable. So there it is, interlacing in weaving and interlooping in knitted structures. Now coming to the warp knitting. Warp knitting also, there are three basic fabric structures that are made. Laces and nets are the one, and then we have the tricot, we call that a tricot knitting or tricot knitting we say, and the rachel knits. So the other two structures, that is, we can make fabrics, a lot many fabrics, in lacy structures, open structures, with the warp knitting and not with weft knitting. And there is a problem with weft knitting, where if one single thread is cut off somewhere, then you can see the whole structure can be removed very easily. But that is not the case in warp knitting. In warp knitting, the structures we say that they are run resistant. Running is one yarn is cut off, you can see a ladder is formed in a knitted fabric which is not present in the warp knitting. So as I was telling you that there are different yarns that are used here, and the three basic methods of knitting is here: the flat beds, the circular beds, and fully fashioned. Flat beds means it is flat, a fabric that is produced is a very flat fabric which has to be cut down later on and then made into a garment. And circular machines will produce a fabric which is very circular, like the vest which the men wear is a circular fabric. So the fabric is, the garment is constructed without a side seam. If you observe their vest, you can see that there is no side seam. So for such purposes, this circular knits are used. And the third one, we call it as fully fashioned, where the versatility of the structure is such that you can make the shape of the garment on the knitting machine. A socks, for example, it doesn't have a stitch line anywhere. So this is called as fully fashioned. So a fully fashioned garment does not require any construction because it is made like that basically on the knitting machine. So mostly for swimwear, for hosiery fabrics, for lingerie wear, the inner garments, the called as lingerie, and many other purposes, you can see that the knitted structures are basically used because they have one big character called as stretchability. And apart from that, their stability in use and care is a little problem, because you all know that when we wash or try to wash a woolen fabric during when it is wet condition, it loses its shape and we are supposed to pull it back to its shape and then dry it flat also, in fact. So only problem with this is the shrinkage. The shrinkage is a little more compared to the woven fabrics. So apart from that, the other structures are very useful, and in fact it has been one of the best fabric structure which is going into the sportswear and the leisure wear. You can see the bands that are used, they are elastic in nature. So there are different structures that can be created. In a sweater, you can see the rest of the garment would be in a different style, and near the cuffs it would be really close to the body, in fact. So the structures are created with the help of needles. There the loom is used, and here the needles are the ones which will help. There are different types of needles that can be used on different types of machines, but they all have a hook which will hold it. So the basic process is that a new loop is always pulled through the old loop. This is how the looping takes place. It is similar to another structure called as crocheting also, in fact. So the characteristics for this would be the number of veils and courses per square inch. If they are good enough, then automatically the fabric is supposed to be having a good quality structure. So coming to the next part of these structures, we have the other methods of making structures which are minute. I mean to say that they are not mostly used in apparel purposes to 100%. They are definitely used in apparel, but unlike the woven structures and the knitted structures. So we can say that 50% is woven and maybe 40% would be knitted, and another 10% would be all these other structures. So when we see the other structures, the first one would be non-woven structure. I was telling you, making structures with yarns is complicated and it requires a lot of amount of time, whereas making structures out of fibers is much easier because you don't need to process that into a yarn and then later on process into a fabric. So directly from the fibers you can make certain structure called the non-woven. So the term itself says that there is no weaving that takes place, there is no yarn formation. Directly the fibers are made into a structure. So here the only thing is they make them into webs. Web is, they may be oriented, maybe all the yarns, all the fibers would be oriented in one direction, and then they crisscross it, each layer. For example, I can tell you the surgical cotton, when you take, you can see layers what comes out, which is unoriented, but still it looks like a structure. So such structures are made together, and then the layers together, depending upon the thickness that is required, depending upon the amount of usage and the end use, these fibers are also, you can use from cellulosic fiber to any other fiber also into this non-ovens. But the more the synthetic fabrics are introduced, the more thermoplastic are introduced, the usage of non-ovens has gone up. because otherwise if it is an ordinary cotton fiber, to make the layers stick on to each other, you have to use an adhesive because there is no other method that can help. And in case of thermoplastic fibers, there is no need of any adhesive. You simply allow some amount of heat here and there so that they cling to each other and they form into a very good structure. So, more thermoplastic fibers have come, there is more of non-oven structures that have come up. So, in fact, making these layers together, there is, we call it as stitch bonding, where stitching mechanism goes on and then make the layers together into one structure. Thermal bonding is using a little heat for thermoplastic fibers only. And in case cotton has to be given thermoplastic or thermal binding, then an amount of this synthetic fiber also has to be there in this, so that this synthetic fiber will help in bonding, whereas the rest of the structure, though it is made of cotton, also can form into a good structure as well. And then we have another process called the chemical bonding as well, where chemicals are used to bind these layers together. And then we have the needle punching, we say. In needle punching, these are only, we have needles which are barbed, that is, it has serrated edges. So, there are many needles per square inch which will work on these layers together, so that, you know, the yarn, the fiber that is present in the all the layers will crisscross and then form into a structure as well. But when we see the end use, we have to select a particular method of making a fabric and then use for a end use, because the structures which are thermally bonded are good enough, because they have real bonding that takes place between the layers. And whereas the structures which have only a cotton and which is stitch bonding, they are not that very strong like that of a thermal bonded fabric. One thing which we find in these non-woven fabrics is they do not have a warp yarn, they do not have a weft yarn. There is no direction, there is no grain. So, and in fact, it is very difficult to tear. A woven fabric, you can tear that by giving a little snip, you can tear the fabric. Whereas, you cannot tear this fabric, a non-oven, you have to cut that or block into shapes and then use it. It can be used because depending upon the number of layers, the thickness would increase. Depending upon the content of the fiber also, you can decide the end use, and mostly it is used for soundproofing. You know, whenever a place has to be soundproofed, you can use this non-oven because they have, or they are called as acoustic material, where they help or reduce the sound from entering inside or from going from inside to outside as well. So, mostly they find their use, and insoles for slippers we find them, and some of the children's garments and especially the fancy dresses and all that, you also find these non-oven fabrics. And now a greater use is found in technical textiles. That means when they are laying a road, you can use a fabric. When they are laying a railway track, a fabric can be used. When they are making a pond and to see that the water does not seep in, you can have a fabric. When you are growing plants for agricultural purpose, to see that the weeds do not come out, you can still use a fabric. So, for all these purposes, now the non-oven fabrics are in great use, because they are helping us to cut down the cost on whatever we spend, maybe for agriculture, for weeding out, for using and pesticides and all that, and some calamities like thunderstorms and all that, heavy rains in such areas, hailstorms. So, for all this, there is a lot of protection that happens. So, for all these purposes, we can see mostly these non-ovens are greatly used these days than in the apparel sector. Apparel sector, it is limited. Maybe you get some soles, chappals, maybe some hats, bags, and such things you generally find. And for bulletin boards and notice boards, you see this non-oven structure being used to a greater extent. So, apart from non-oven, we also have a fabric called felt. A felt is slightly different from non-oven, though the basic structure is only using fibers in the non-oven as well as in the felt. Here in the non-oven, what happens is you are making bats of material or layers of material and then using different methods. In felting, we use only one method, wherein the maximum felt is done in woolen fiber. So, because when we see the woolen fiber, it has some scales on the surface which will make to cling on to one another very easily. So, making that as an advantage, this has been used. And in fact, when we see all these other structures which we are doing right now are not very new to us, because it was done prehistoric times also. because matted material is something as the nomads were moving around killing the animals and wearing their skin. So they found that because over a period of time, because of rubbing action, the hair was made into a fabric structure. So that is how the felt material has come into existence. So here what they do is, there are two different felts, we say wool felt and then fur felt. Wool felt is something which is exclusively made from wool fibers, and it may contain a little of any other fiber, but it does not have a very good appearance. It is dull in appearance and the strength is also not good enough, and you get a very rough surface. And the other fur felt is obtained from the animal fibers like rabbit and other animals, which will make the structure more pliable and water repellent and also very soft in texture, which goes mostly for hats and other things. So both these structures, when they want to make them, so the fiber is made in the form of a sheets, and then it is sprinkled with warm water first, because a felt is made with a little temperature, friction and pressure. These three are required for making a felt. So these layers of material are sprinkled with warm water first, and then they are passed over a steam box to introduce heat into the structure, and then they will be sent into between two oscillating rollers, which will be oscillating at a very higher speed. So because of the moisture content, because of the heat that is applied and the friction and the pressure that is between the oscillating rollers, you get a fabric which comes out is a felted material. So it is a structure which we cannot separate them together. So after coming out, it is cooled and then it is soaped first, and then for lubrication, and then sometimes they shear it properly so that there is a very even surface on the thing, and it goes into the market. So wherever you want a blocked structures, wherever that is possible, you can use. And mostly because it is made from hair fiber, it is supposed to be giving more warmth compared to any other fabric. Similar to felt, here this one also cannot have any warp grain or weft grain or whatever grain, but it only can be cut into samples. But one more problem with both felts and non-woven is, sewing is becomes a problem, because when the needle goes through many layers, when needle coming out would be a problem, because it may get entangled in the thing. So sewing is one difficulty with these fabrics. And when suppose some, there is some tear somewhere in the fabric anywhere, you cannot mend it. So that is going to be one more problem with these fabrics. So it can be cut and then make into any shape for any particular purposes. So that is with regard to the felt materials. So the other structure which we have is a braided structure, which an example is our hair, which we braid using different strands. So similarly, we have structures in 2D and 3D also, that is in two dimensional and three dimensional. The shoelaces which we get are round, spherical, that is 3D braiding. It's a braiding technique where the yarns are first put parallel to each other, and then it is braided in such a way diagonally the yarns move. So thereby creating a structure which can be used, if it is a smaller one or a thinner one, it can be used as a trimming. And otherwise, if it is a three-dimensional, it will be round and circular, which is having a hollow surface inside, or maybe it can be a complete one, which is mostly used for insulating wires. You know, the electric irons and all will have a wire which over it we can see a structure on the surface of the wire. So for all such purposes, braiding is used. And mostly for trimmings and other things, we use this braided structure in the apparel fabrics. The other structure is macrame, where macrame is exclusively done with only knots. So the knotting is something very different. There are different knots, like half knot we say, or full knot we say. So the knots are arranged in such a way that at different intervals, different knots are given to make a whole structure. So it is a very, very open structure, and it can be used over garments. And mostly when you see the julas and all those, which we see, are made with this structure of macrame. Only knotting takes place there. Only thing is, we have to use a stronger yarn there to make the knots, because the whole structure is knots and it relies on the knots only. So the yarn that is used for macrame would be very stronger enough. And you know, there are people who walk on the ramp with a complete garments made out of even the macrame. It's been popularized very greatly these days about macrame. the next structure we get is nets. Nets are available, nets are supposed to be those structures which are also made by knotting structure previously, but now nets are available in weaving, in knitting you can make nets, and any other thermoplastic fiber also you can make net. The characteristic feature of net is having either a square opening or a diamond shaped opening, an open structure which is very airy. And in fact, these structures are also used in the sportswear where they require a lot of, something like an athlete running for a longer time. So these structures are used here and there where they require a lot of aeration for the body to make them cooler and then perform in a better way. So the net structures are nowadays done even on a rachel knitting machines, the warp knitting methods, and even the other methods. But basically, the knotted ones are supposed to be the strongest one, but now whatever is being made either in the weaving process or in the knitting process do not have that strength compared to that of a knotted structure. So the next method we have is making a lace. Lace, a bobbin lace, is something which is known to all of us because it is a woman's job, and all this macrame, crocheting, lace making, net making, all these structures were done manually by the women to supplement their income. And over a period of time, all these structures now are being made with the on the machine. We know hand embroidery is one aspect where it is done with the machine these days, and you have the whole width of the fabric that is done on the embroidery as well. So similarly, here we have the lace making, which was a bobbin lace in the beginning, and now we have the lace making which is done on the same rachel knits and the tricot knits, which produces a very intricate type of things which are used especially for the sofa back covers. If you have seen the markets, we are getting different embroidered types in the form of knits which are used because they do not ravel out. You simply cut and then use it, you don't need to finish them off. So they are gaining popularity again in the apparel sector as well as in the household sector as well. And the next method that is used is we have multi-component fabrics. Multi-component, as the word suggests, we see that instead of one type of fabric, there are two different fabrics which are used together, either by lamination or by bonding them together, so that the end fabric which we get will not be unlike the first fabric or the second fabric. So we are getting a fabric with all the qualities of both these fabrics, and that we call it as a multi-component. A multi-component means having more than one component at a time. And these are done by different methods, either by using an adhesive there or by a resin, you can use the multi-component fabrics. For example, you see the synthetic leather, which looks like a leather, polyurethane. So that is also used for coating the fabric, where you can see a coating is done and the grains texture is given on the surface, which resembles like a leather fabric, and it's not a pure leather in fact. And we have one more variety called the tufted fabrics, where the background fabric is first made, and then the tufts in the form of long threads are introduced into the base structure, and then they are cut off to a distance. And how to make them compact is sometimes they shrink the basic structure. By shrinking the basic structure, they hold these yarns which are being introduced as the tufts. Or the other method is they apply a adhesive at the back of the structure so that whatever has been introduced as the tuft will not be removed. And the third method is the tufts, these are also yarns. So the yarns are raveled out in such a way that it forms a very open structure, and they are not removed out of the basic structure. So these tufted fabrics are mostly used in the carpet area. All the tufted carpets are an example for this tufted structures. And we have also the bonded structures, the laminated, where they are laminated on one over the other. And we have the quilting. You all know what are the quilts are, different layers of fabrics put together and then stitched up. Actually, a quilting should have three components majorly. One is both the layers on either side, forming one is one layer, the second layer, and in between you should have a fiber filling or something so that it gives the third dimension to the fabric. So these quilting fabrics are almost stitched generally, and now the stitching has been removed, where we have a thermal bonding, because when we use one layer as a thermal fabric, that means to say a fabric which can melt with temperature, and the other a normal fabric, and when you have in between a wadding material or a material that will be filled up in between, so when you use this thermal here and there, So it is like stitching. So instead of real thread and needle there, they use the heat and then stitch them up together. And there are also many other methods that by which we do a lot of quilting also. So, and the last method I would talk about is the crochet method, which we all know. We use a hooked needle which can come into the garments, bags, wallets, accessories. All the accessories that are being done are also done in the crochet. Macrame is one thing which is also done in the accessories for fashion wear. Crochet is one thing that is also used in this. And so for macrame, we generally use number of threads at a time. For crocheting, we use only one single thread, and the whole structure is done with one single thread, but with different methods of looping. It is almost similar to knitting, where new loops are taken out from the old loops, but the types of looping is something very different. It is a hand method mostly, crocheting, and these are some of the different methods that can be used to make a basic structure apart from the basic weaves and the knitting structures, which are majorly used in the apparel and elsewhere sectors.
Ma'am, as you said, minimum width of the fabric is 36 inches, and you also said that maximum width is also possible. How do you think it is possible?
Yeah, good question. Thing is, as I told you, on a hand loom, the 36 inch is possible. Now we have machines where we do not have a shuttle, called the shuttleless looms. So with the help of air, with the help of water, and all these possible things are, we have the looms which are set to a longer width, so that, you know, this air will help the weft yarn to be placed even longer widths, which is not possible by the human person. So because of that, we are able to get all the different types of greater widths these days.
How do we identify woven fabric from different fabric?
Woven fabric from different fabrics.
Knitted fabric.
Okay, knitted fabric. So as I told you, the basic structure for a woven fabric will be having warp yarns and the weft yarns. So when you ravel out, or when you see towards the light, you can see the yarns running straight and yarns running crosswise also. You can ravel out and also find out. In case of knitted fabric, you can see that when you try to remove, you can see the loop structure on the structure, I mean on the surface as it is. And also when you try to remove, the yarn comes out in the form of loops. Basically by looking at it, you can identify. Only non-woven fabrics, the other one is how you cannot see any structure there. It is a complicated one. It is form of a web. Coming to other structures like crocheting, macrame and all that, you can see the knots, which are very open structures. And net, I told you, it has an opening, a square opening or a diamond opening, which is used for various purposes. So basically by looking at every structure, you can identify which is a woven structure, which is a knitted structure, which is a non-woven, and the other methods also.